I will analyze the political and historical evolution of Anagni, this little city in southern Lazio, through the analysis of the history of the Cathedral of Anagni, that is the Cathedral of Saint Mary. So before talking about the cathedral, let me tell you something about the city of Anagni. So it's in the southern part of the region called Lazio, so south side from Rome. And Anagni was founded by the Ernici, that is a tribe of Osco-Sabellian origins. And as with the majority of the towns in Lazio, it is only from the dawn of the Roman times that the major public works began to take place. So the original urban core of Anagni was limited to the highest part of the town, in the area that now is the site of the cathedral, and a naturally safe zone from a strategic point of view. With progressive conditions of peace and economic growth, the urban structure changed radically, and the town underwent expansion, reaching the modern day's borders. New walls were built following the course of the hills, and irregularities in terrain were negotiated through the use of raised terraces. In the early Middle Ages, we witnessed the religious reoccupation of the Acropolis. Is this for the light? Yes, that is right over here. And that was the focal point of the city through the construction of the first cathedral, now replaced by the subsequent Romanesque building. From the 12th century, the town would experience a gradual expansion linked to the intense political activity related to the struggle between papacy and empire. A symbol of this distinctive moment is the destruction of the early medieval cathedral and the construction of a new impressive building. Along with the rise of the first municipal structures and the subdivision of the territory into districts, the development of the civil architecture was to become paramount. And in the following century, the city would become one of the preferred seats of the papal court, and the urban physiognomy, as perceivable today, came into effect in this period. Finally, at the beginning of the 14th century, Anagni was to enter into a period of gradual decline. The first blow would come in 1303 with the famous incident of the schiaffo, literally the slap, and along with their consequent exile in Avignon, the city lost its function as a seat for the pontiff. So now we should look into the early medieval phase of the cathedral. It is possible to observe the spread of Christianity in the territories of the diocese of Anagni from the 4th century. The limits of the territory are not known, and as with those of other dioceses of Lazio, it is only possible to reconstruct this from the 13th or 14th century onwards. Moreover, with research in its current state, it is not possible to determine the location of the early Christian cathedral, as excavation carried out in the area were not extensive. For the medieval period, however, there exists a confluence of historical, artistic, and archaeological data, meaning it is possible to build a clearer profile. So let's have a look at the early Middle Ages. Along the west side of the building, there are testimonies about the walls that speak of two distinct phases. This is the first one. The Tartar stone blocks tracing along one of the terraces of the Roman era, followed then by the construction of heterogeneously cut limestone and sandstone blocks, cemented together with mortar, supposed to form a large underground area. Masonry and cementing were pertinent for the new building, superimposed entirely over the Roman one, and with a definite change in orientation with respect to this one. Similar masonry have been found under the forecourt of the current cathedral, also characterized by blocks similar to those already mentioned, albeit this time resting on a large wall of tuff, which had evidently been relocated, and also in this case with a trend different to that of the existing cathedral. Both walls can be compared with those of other important ecclesiastical buildings of the area, such as Farfa, San Vincent in Volturno, and Sant'Ilario in Valmontone, all of which are characterized by having had construction phases between the 8th and 9th century. The two walls therefore belong to a single phase, characterized by having made use of structures from the Roman era. This chronology is further confirmed by the presence of blocks made of reused tuff, a unique form of construction employed in Rome during the Carolingian period. Finally, with regards to the Carolingian period, it is interesting to analyze the position of the belfry, of axis with respect to the Romanesque building, but aligned with the central and right-hand side naves, likely indicating an early medieval forepart reconverted into a bell tower at the time of the Romanesque rebuilding. These elements, which move away from the Romanesque walls, contribute to locate early Middle Ages cathedral in the present location. The bishop's authority would therefore have already occupied the highest part of the town from this period onwards. Evidence in form of these materials, analyzed together with some documents and parts of surviving early medieval ornaments, allow for the outlining of a prominent role of St. Mary in the early medieval landscapes of southern Lazio, putting the construction of the building into a context of wider reorganization plan of the Carolingian territory. In actual fact, Anagni is included amongst the territories counted in the Pactum Ludovicianum, a document handed down to us from the 11th and 12th centuries, albeit as a copy of verified authenticity. The importance of the Pactum, beyond the context presented here, is that it was the first in a series of agreements established between Frankish and Roman authorities, thus representing an essential reference for relations between the papacy and the empire. The Pactum is an imperial privilege that confirms the control of the Church of Rome on these territories and gives funds in order to assure patrimonial livelihood to the different cathedrals. From a monumental point of view, the inclusion of Anagni amongst the territories of the Pactum is celebrated by a set of marble fragments with epigraphic text, alluding to the actions of the Bishop Rumaldus, who, at the time of the construction of the new church, wanted to eternalize the acquisitions made during the pontificate of Leo III through a vast program of decoration. The epigraph is a carta lapidaria, namely a transposition on enduring and monumental support of legal acts, which is further enhanced by the adjective widespread because the engravings are on different components. The epigraphs are the product of a single stonemason's workshop, as demonstrated by the paleographic homogeneity. I don't know if you can see something from the video. Of the characters, which on different parts repeat the same graphic solution, not only in the tracing of the letters, but also in the resolution of links and abbreviations. Analysis of the inscription technique has shown that the decorations and the epigraph were contextual and contemporary, creating an harmonious ensemble dating from the 9th century. Biographical data from Rumaldus confirm this dating. He does indeed appear among the signatories of the Roman Synod of 826. Analysis of the morphology and measurements, paying particular attention to the thickness and arrangement of writing and decoration, has allowed for the identification of an altar frontal, a pluteus forming part of a presbytery enclosure or of a solea, and an overdoor. The pieces were then placed in different parts of prestige in the church as spatial markers for the attendance areas of the liturgical space. One of the main values of the Carta of Anagni lies in the possibility to further advance hypotheses on its original location. Generally, indeed, these inscriptions are presented as decontextualized marble slabs affixed to walls. The case under consideration, however, thanks to the presence of the sculptural element, can still communicate a lot about the original location of the pieces, their role in the scanning of the liturgical space, and their ability to herald the engraved message. From the position of the pieces, or located in the areas of the building inhabited by the clergyman for their specific functions, it follows that the real beneficiary of the inscribed messages was the clergy itself, responsible for the administration of the goods listed in the Carta. This once again confirms the tendency of exposed writings from the Italian early medieval ages, in which images and writings are situated in the most sacred and inaccessible parts of the building, physically far away from even the possibility to approach and eventually read the inscribed message. The writing assumes an iconic value, in that it would be consciously reused by Peter of Salerno when, after the deconstruction of the early medieval building for the reconstruction of the cathedral, reused some of the inscriptions and sculptures for the beautification of the facade. Peter thus declared his bond with the predecessor, Romaldus, with whom he shared the Lombard origins, the monastic tradition of the Benedictine, and a common political position, being Peter an advocate of the Gregorian reform, and Romaldus the protagonist during the most propulsive moment of the Church in the Carolingian period. Now we turn to analyze the Romanesque phase of St. Mary. The Romanesque cathedral was constructed by Bishop Peter of Salerno in the second half of the 11th century. Two different documents provide chronological clues for the beginning of the construction. The first, from 1068, involves the acquisition of some land to be used for the expansion of the early medieval building. The second informs us that in 1072, Peter returned from Byzantium with funds and workforce for the construction. In 1097, he was taking part in the First Crusade, before returning to Anagni, bringing with him additional funding for the construction. The cathedral would then finally be consecrated in 1104, 1 year before his death. The Romanesque building is predominantly constructed of large square blocks, left exposed to view, with a variable height of between 40 and 46 centimeters and a base of around 40 to 80 centimeters, with carefully cut edges to allow for very thin joints to be used. This form of construction is present in almost all of the lower perimeter of the church, up to the height of about 5 meters. It's right over here. The facade deviates slightly from this technique, registering rather more of a decorative richness, inserting some reused Roman and early medieval elements. In the lower Lazio region, the first symbolic reuse of ancient fragments and their arrangement inside new buildings can be traced back to the abbot Desiderius of Monte Cassino, who would order the purchase and transportation of colored marble from Rome in 1066. For the beautification of the Abbey Church. The Cathedral of Bishop Peter thus is a clear reference to the Cassinist experience, as it is most evidently expressed in the facade, produced with a figurative design in which the decorative choices were bound to the celebration of the past. This implementation of structures reflects a highly specialized construction site, organized in a joint work effort between the workers, among which the stone masons were the flagstones of a group leading delicate tasks, such as shaping of the materials as well as the assembly. Considering the construction itself, the usage of square blocks is significant, above all as the territory thus far had largely been characterized by the presence of unskilled workers, used to treating the local material with an approximate rough-handedness and to assembling them within more or less ordered parameters. Peter's experience thereby represents an exceptional enterprise for both Lower Lazio and Anagni, showing high-level cultural and international influence that is reflected in the employment of such an advanced construction technique. It is possible to draw several conclusions about the 13th century cathedral, discernible in particular in the completion of the central apse and the closing of summit of the transept. It uses stones of smaller dimension, 20 to 22.5 centimeters high, which are linked with the marble decorative elements, tiny parts assembled rather than stone-shaped, as has been found in the previous structure. The construction now assumes a serial character. The pieces are similar to each other, and it's the method of assembly that entrusted with the solution to the main constructive and formal problems, bringing out a more centralized role of the builders in the execution of the work. The work of the stonemasons now diminishes to give way to that of the sculptor, who enriches the cathedral with a number of figurative themes, moving away from the geometric solution and the classical language of the first structure. Slowly, a completely different procedure for the organization of work on construction site emerged, a far cry from the autonomic and internal organization of Peter's project, dependent on the economic capability of the customer and technical skills. The widespread diffusion in Lower Lazio of this technique using square stones between the 13th century and the start of the 14th infers that this production process provided an embryonic form of prefabrication of material, likely to be sourced either from the quarry or at the edge of the construction site, to facilitate subsequent installation on site by masonry, specialized or not. The analysis of the events from the early medieval and Romanesque period surrounding the Cathedral of St. Mary thus allow us to shed light on the historical and political evolution of Anagni, which in the medieval age started to undergo progressive secularization, supported by a wider distribution of wealth, gradually moving away from an aristocratic way of selecting materials and workers toward reaching a shared management with other construction sites, including civilian, located around the territory, reflecting the increased importance of the local authority. Thank you very much.